Okay, well, yeah, welcome everybody. Today we have a very special colloquium. It's Daniele Amati. I think it's everybody knows Daniele, but I think I'd better say something about him. He's one of those persons that doesn't need an introduction. Daniele, even though the subject is the emergence of modern humans, Daniele is a high energy physicist. And he has been in many institutions in France and at CERN, especially for most of the career. Then he came to Trieste. He was the director of CISA for many years, and he's still now at CISA. He has been a special figure also for ICTP. He has been very close to ICTP for all these years since he came to Trieste and probably before. Also, yes, I think you were here also since almost the beginning of ICTP.
Yes.
He appears in the picture, the famous picture of 1960, when ICTP was conceived. A young person there, the youngest and handsome person is Daniel. So it's a historical member for ICTP, but I consider Daniele like a father figure. You can always see him as a person.
Grandfather.
A grandfather. Yeah, but it's also a role model of how you can see a scientist being passionate for science all through his career and evolving from different subjects and still being active at all different ages. And being able to also to change subjects from high energy physics to neuroscience and the emergence of humans now. Yes, we had a dinner recently with Daniele and Miguel Virasoro, the former director, and Elisa, my wife. And when I came back after the dinner, I told Elisa, I wish I would be as sharp as Daniele is now when I am his age. But then I thought about it. So I wish I will be as sharp as he is right now, even at this age, because he's still as sharp as ever. And we better leave Daniele to start and give the talk.
Okay, thank you very much, Fernando. You are really, I see, being very close to my heart in many aspects. For me, it was a torture to leave the surrounding, and now they're far away. But nevertheless, we keep contacts, and that is very, very important. Now, funny that high energy physics is speaking about that, but I tell you how it started. It started that I brought some time ago a group of cognitive scientists at CISA for a meeting, and I was speaking after dinner with them, and I said, how happens that humans are really this incredible capacity to change the world, to understand and change the world? We are the only species that goes that. What is the extra gear? What makes that? And I was expecting an answer, and I didn't receive any answer. I thought it, think it about. Kept not hearing any answer. Therefore, I dragged one of them, Tim Challis. He was one of the group, a neuropsychologist, and we started discussing and thinking, and it came out, the first paper that we wrote together was published in 2007, and this is a theoretical paper that explains when, how, and why. So you will hear about today. Okay, it's quite pretentious what I'm saying, but well, you must keep pretentious if not one gets really old. All right, now, I give you here a plan of the talk. Since then, we did this theoretical paper, but you see, in neuroscience, there is no theory and experiment. Either you prove what you are saying, or what you're saying is nothing. And therefore, since then, I work experimentally to put my finger on the process. And we are working there, and I will explain to you at what stage we are in this process. I'm still working on that, and we are at a certain stage that I hope will end soon, before I end, at least. Okay, so here is the plan. I will first tell you facts, the facts to identify what I call human capacities, and especially distinguish them. You see, the cognitive capacity of animals are very similar to ours. We'll go through. So distinguish this human capacity from animals, and especially from our predecessors, hominins. This would be important to understand when, to date the appearance of this cognitive, of human, the modern human cognitive capacities. Then, so these are facts. Then I will tell you about our model, if you want, therefore a theoretical proposition. This means I will propose a mental process that involved by humans and that characterizes the humans, infer from the mental process a novel mental operation that only humans have, and then I will discuss with you possible brain mechanisms that underlie that mental operation. Okay? Then I will discuss with you experimental searches. This means to identify the proposed human mental operation in a lab experiment and explore with imaging, it means with a functional MRI, what happens in the brain, and then what happens in the brain that underlies that particular mental operation. I will tell you where we are now in this experimental search. And at the end, depending on the time I will have still, I will tell you some developmental and anthropological aspects, which are interesting things. Okay, let's go. So here are human cognitive capacities. You see, these are strictly human, means that animals have not. Even if animals have therefore it is important, I will discuss some of them, it's very important to distinguish the human capacities from animal capacities and also from human proto-capacities. Our ancestor differed from us very, very little and therefore have proto-capacities, and it's important to try to understand which are these proto-capacities. Well, here you have many, and I will discuss only very few. The first one, of course, is language. I don't need to tell you what it is. But when I speak of language, it means language, not communication, language. You know, language is a very complex system. It's universal, have a precise rules, which is generative grammar, which are all the same. Everybody has the same. There can be differences from one language to another one, in the sense that in English we say, John bought a book, therefore, subject, verb, and object. In other languages, we say a book bought John, and so on. But nevertheless, the structure is always the same. The order can be different, and it will be. When I say the language is the same, means all languages, including, for instance, sign languages, which are also have exactly the same structure than the spoken language, even if they are totally different. Okay, so. This is, by the way, language is not meant, as Chomsky says, language is not meant to communicate. The communication is a secondary thing. Animals also communicate, and surely the Neanderthal also was communicating, but language is not communication. It's a way to organize symbolically concepts and eventually to communicate to others. And there are very interesting work on with humans to see proto-languages. Because even in humans now, there are humans who didn't get, for instance, deaf people, son of speaking people, develop a sign language even if they are not taught. Even it is sufficient that they are together, they communicate, it is sufficient. However, if they are isolated, they will never acquire a language. They have what is called a home sign. They can communicate with the parents, but they don't have the structure of the language. By the way, the structure of the language has many properties. Not only it's universal and has rules, but for instance, it's potentially infinite recursive. You can open have a sentence that opens a new sentence. The book that John bought, the day he was going to, and so on, you can open a sentence within the other, and it's potentially infinitely recursive, This is another characteristic of the language. This is only language of humans, and no other animal has. Even if the communication animal has. Communication, however, of animals is wired in, also our language is wired in, by the way. It's wired in, however, it needs others to develop. And there are very interesting examples that I will not say, because if not, I will lose my time in secondary things. Okay. So language is the first one. There is no evidence that anybody else had language. It is not clear when language appeared in human beings. I will tell you a bit what paleoanthropologists think. Another example which is good is Tulan instruments. Now, Tulan instruments, of course, is the opposite. There are a lot of data because paleoanthropology has a lot. And human beings were tool users. By the way, apes are also tool users since many years. For instance, humans were very good stone flinters since a million years. However, there is a development in tools and instruments, and the developments are classified by paleoanthropologists, and the last development is around 40, 50,000 years ago. And for instance, I remember an anthropologist saying that if you put this fourth class, which is the modern one, and the third one in the table, for instance, axes, all axes are cut stones which are bound to a stick. It's only that. And humans had axes since million years. Okay, so that if you put it on the table, you realize that there is a difference. And the difference is the systematization. So obviously, you see, everybody had a cutting stone and a stick to throw it far away. However, the maximization, which implies the optimization with respect to the force of the arm, this was a computation of the last period, which starts around 40, 50, 60 years ago. There are many other examples, not many of these properties left data. For instance, meta representation, logic and algorithmic rules. Some, yes, for instance, signs and signals also. The painting is a typical characteristic, but even signs. And so that paleoanthropologists now got a consensus. By the way, it's funny because there is a Republica of last week in which there is a very nice article of Tattersall. Tattersall is a top paleoanthropologist in the world, and he was in Italy. He got a prize at the book show in Torino, which is a very nice article, and says exactly what I will say to you, that there is a consensus that there is something that happened around 50, 60,000 years ago, in which everything changed very drastically. Now, this is the consensus. The way in which it changed, whether it is a revolution or it was over 10,000 years, is a share, but for me it's the same. Say, seen with the evolution time space, that's nothing. Therefore, something happened. Around 50, 60,000 years ago, something happens that without, by the way, 60,000 years ago, Homo sapiens means us, which is anatomically and genetically mature, was around 600,000 years. Was already around, something happened that without any speciesization, without any change in species, these humans got this extra gear. And he speculates, first of all, he says this cannot be natural selection. Of course, there is no time for natural selection to act so quickly. And by the way, natural selection is never finalistic. It is not an improvement. And therefore, it is not natural selection. This is completely. And then what it is? Now, they use often the word exaptation, which exaptation means that something can be dormant, and then there is something that suddenly appears. And the best example of that is feathers. The feathers are in animals since very long time. They were developed through natural selection in order to isolate from temperature. And only much, much later were used to fly. So this is the example of exaptation. Now, unfortunately, they cannot say, give any example of exaptation. Some of them say it was dormant and it is the language that created the jump, but this is simply a magic stick, because then you must tell me how the language appeared. So due to the fact that the language is one of the crucial human capacities, we are again at case zero. Therefore, from my point of view, exaptation is useless. It's a useless concept. It's a magic stick. Okay. So, let's go on. So, this is what I was saying, the general consensus, paleanthropologists, you can read that, but Tattersall is a known figure since 20 years, therefore, this is a sheer chance that I got Repubblica last week. But, okay. It is no specization, as I was telling to you. No classical natural selection mechanism. Exaptation for me is a non-explanation. And then, of course, we are scientists, and therefore we are reductionists, and therefore it is clear that our attitude would be to try to understand what is the change in the underlying mental processes. Finally, cognitive capacities are mental processes, and therefore what could be a change in the underlying mental process. And this is what I will tell you about. Not only, of course, mental process must change, but if we are reductionists, we know that behind the mental process there are brain processes. Therefore, we must understand also how happens that without changing the brain is the same that we have, but we share with our predecessor, with Homo sapiens of 200,000 years ago. How can happen that with the same brain we can have this new thing going on? And this is what I will try to present to you. By the way, sorry? You can do what you want. Yes, of course. They are all together. Theory of mind is here. Theory of mind, look. Yes. Yes. By the way, the people agree that it's very probable that they appear always all together. In other words, and this is what I will try to find. I will try to find the mechanism that that will show that indeed the extra gear produces one can produce all of them. By the way, all of them, as I will tell you in a moment, share some basic properties which are the same that we have discussed for language. Potentially infinite recursivity and so on. Okay. Now, indeed, what I will try to say is that all these properties have the same characteristic, which is fluidity. As you can think about the language, but you can also go to the theory of mind. I know that he knows that I know that he knows. Something like that, you can go on infinitely. It's infinite recursivity. And in all of them, we find this potential infinite recursivity, fluidity, and so on. What I'm saying is that they all appear together, not only appear together, but they appear together with a general property that may handle all these varieties of capacities in a symbolic way in order to make projects. And what I would say is that the common thing that unites everything and is abstract projectuality. When I say abstract projectuality, it means a project that men do, which is not necessarily to satisfy a need and then obtain it, but it's an abstract project. Go out and see, and you will find the world is an abstract project. Understand physics is an abstract project. To build how to become a professor, whatever thing, are abstract projects. The human beings all have abstract projects. Even a guy that is illiterate has an abstract project. To have carrots, which are nicer than somebody else, and so on. Okay. So what I will try to show is that all this property, that all the human cognitive capacity have are found also in abstract projectuality. Abstract projectuality is the thing that puts everything together and allows us, indeed, to understand and change the world. So here it is. That's the mental process that I will try to... Mental process is different from mental operation. That's what, mental process is a process. Many mental operations. So that, these are the basic characteristics of the of after projectuality and also of all the human capacity that I said before. No need of sensory stimuli. You can want to build a house without needing to change house. Or novel goals. The goal can achieve can be novel. Not you can copy it from somebody else, but you can also invent one by yourself. May require new strategies to get it. This is a very typical. There is a recursivity. There is a potential time protraction. You can have a project interrupted, restarted before. There is eventual discontinuity. You can stop it. And there is mental effort. As you know, when you are doing physics, which is a very good after project, you sweat. As I'm sweating now, that because I'm trying to pass you an information. That's a project that I have. Nobody, I'm hungry to tell you, but I wish to tell you. So this is an after project and takes a mental effort. And they imply fluent, non-routine thought. These are all characteristics. And it will appear even clearer what is abstract projectuality going on. There is a difference between concrete projectuality. Concrete projectuality also animals have very clear concrete projects that can be very complex. Think of ants, bees. They have very complex projects. These complex projects, however, are wide-inged. They are the same for all members of the community, while our projects are very different from between any one of us. Therefore, there is a difference between what I call abstract project and concrete project. Now, any mental process, abstract or concrete, it is a consists of a succession of mental operations. Now, mental operations have been discussed and studied by neuroscientists. I will tell you very quickly how they are organized. These are the mental operations, which are the operations are essentially shared with mammals and apes, also with preceding creatures, but at least some which need a prefrontal cortex, you find them in mammals and apes. This is a way in which neuroscientists divide the mental operation. There are automatic. Automatic are non-conscious. For instance, the way in which we reconstruct the three-dimensional view from the back of the retina, which is two-dimensional, it is a very complex procedure, which is the same for us and for a cat, is the same, and it's a very complex thing which is automatic. For instance, if I must take this up, I must put in a function, a lot of muscles to balance, not only a lot of muscles of my hand that will grab this, but also to compensate the weight, evaluate the weight of that and compensate my center of gravity. Therefore, it's a very complex procedure which have to put in work many muscles in my body. And this is an automatic thing that all animals do, okay? And these are non-conscious, are automatic, in that sense, are automatic. Then there are routine operations. Routine operations are learned, are conscious in general, drive, walk, speak, what many things, but they imply no cognitive effort. You do it without any, you must work it out. The effort is to put in what I want to say, but not to speak. To speak for me is automatic. They are superposable. You can do several routine operations together. You can drive, speak, and sing. But speak and sing is more complex. sing and tapple with the fingers. I don't put it like that as you want. These are the routine operations. And then finally, there are what is called supervisory operations. By the way, different neuroscientists call them in a different way. I use here the way of my colleague Tim Challis, but they are practically. The supervisory actually implies a strategy. The supervisory has a goal, it's an objective that can be concrete or abstract, and modulates a succession of routine operation. For instance, if you want to make a coffee, then you must first unscrew, put water, put the coffee in. You make this succession of automatic operations. They involve cognitive effort. They involve cognitive effort. If you think to other things in general, you will screw what you're doing. And then you have one at a time, a strategy at a time. You can have two strategies together. These are the three mental operations that we share with animals, of course. And I will say, I am not telling about to here, but mental operation, this mental operation is well known which parts of the brain they involve. As you know, there are a lot of studies of how the brain functions. They were studied before through impairments. People that had troubles in the brain were not able to do some things. Now, with imaging, you can study them much more easy. But it is rather well known which are the parts of the brain that enter into this. And these parts of the brain are the same for apes and humans, and also for mammals. More developed, of course, in some animals than in others, but they are essentially the same. God, this is... where is my friend? Because this is the old. Yes. I guess this is the old project. There are small differences, but perhaps I don't need. There are a few differences between the... I prefer... This is the new. Very good. I can use that. There is no big difference. Sorry. No. We are at 4. No. 5. Okay. Here we were. Okay. Thank you.
Just a minute.
There are small differences. You want to give me also that? I can use this.
Okay.
Yeah, but you must tell me how I use it. Like that? Here. Very good. Okay. So this is what I was saying to you, Rachel. Now, here comes my hour by the proposition, which is published in Cognition 2007. Thank you. It's published in Cognition 2007. Which is the basic proposition. The basic proposition is that there is one human novel mental operation that only humans have. And this allows abstract projectuality and therefore allows all the fluidity that operations have. And this, what is this, this new operation, is that a strategy may change to another one if we are unsatisfied of the preceding strategy. This is something typical that when you make a calculation in physics, you are having a project, you want to follow a strategy, then you are unsatisfied because the strategy is not convenient, you don't know how to handle all the data, you change strategy. Now, each strategy implies an operation, I would say operations, there are operations, which are, if you want an operation, are a sort of maximization in parameters that are the parameters that are relevant to the strategy. Nature has an infinite number of parameters. When we do a calculation or we play chess, or we do whatever thing, we don't consider an infinite number of parameters, we consider a limited number of parameters. A limited number of parameters are those that we consider relevant for the strategy. Therefore, it is we work in a small parameter space. And a strategy is finally an optimization in this parameter space in order to get our goal. Okay? Now, if you are satisfied, you are frustrated that the strategy is not correct, we are able to change strategy without any external input. You are unsatisfied because it is too heavy, too complex, and you can change. By the way, when you change, you can explore a different set of parameters. For instance, you can leave some apart, get some new ones, and so on. Therefore, you are
you can even change the space of parameter in which this operation works, in which this strategy works. The strategy, as I tell you, is a program, it's an optimization. Okay, so this capacity of changing a strategy to another one without any external input, we claim that's a property of abstract, a property of human beings. It's something that you make every day when you solve crosswords, whatever, when you play chess, when you make a calculation in physics, you, every day you are using this capacity. Animals don't have that. Animals have concrete projects, I was saying, and they have very complex strategies. The lion chasing has a very complex strategy, and the strategy may change. For instance, if the wind changes, or there is see another lion around, he will change strategy. But the strategy changes not because frustration, but because something changed from outside. Therefore, what I'm saying is that what is essentially human is the capacity of one strategy, therefore one supervisor operation, to latch another one, to create another one, without any external intervention. This is the basic assumption that we do. Okay? This is the basic assumption that we do. Now, let me go ahead. Now, how happens that a new mental operation, this change of strategy, may happen with the same brain structure? We're saying that the brain has not changed. Now, this, of course, for neuroscientists is impossible. Neuroscientists are accustomed that the frontopolar makes that, parietal makes that, and so on, to make something that with the same brain, make something different with the same brain is for them very complex. For us, physicists, it's a triviality. We're every day having that. Between a conductor and a superconductor, the structure is the same. However, we are full of examples in which there are phase transitions, and phase transitions imply that there is a major global change with a minor local change when there is a critical parameter that overcomes a threshold. Therefore, what we propose is that latching comes from a phase transition in the brain. This is what we say. Now, of course, to stay there is not sufficient. We must say what happens. We claim that connectivity in the brain is a critical parameter. Connectivity. Now, why that? First of all, a typical thing of phase transition is that there are a change in what are coherent correlations, isn't it? And therefore, this gives a long-range correlation, which is something which is needed. You change the strategy if you aren't satisfied. Therefore, you must have the feeling system, which is very very deep in the brain, very old in the brain, that must go together with decision making, which is frontwise. Therefore, you must have a new set of long-range correlation. Not only, but by the way, we asked a colleague to make a simple model, and this connectivity was supported by a simple connectionist model that Treves, a colleague of us, developed. This was a sort of POTS model in which a small change, POTS model has some minima that recognize external excitation. The minima, when excited, gets down exponentially, and if the connectivity gets a bit above a certain threshold, then instead of decaying exponentially, then goes down exponentially, excites another one, excites another one, and at the end you get a power law decrease, a change in the decrease, with a successive iteration of other minima. Not only, but then connectivity is a late phylogenetic and ontogenetic development, very late. We have developed connectivity, we are still developing connectivity now. When I say developing does not mean that increases. Increases and prunes, therefore changes. But connectivity is something very late, not only, but is not conditioned by both genetic material. It's not the conduction of connectivity. The way in which an axon goes around and branches somewhere is not determined by biology, but determined by many things, including external factors, epigenetic and extrasomatic influences. Therefore, is a biological fact that is not determined by biological entities, but it is supported by epigenetic and extrasomatic influence. And this is exactly what we want. Indeed, I will even tell you how may happen that 40,000 years ago this happened. Okay? But I will tell you that at the end. Okay, so that's the end of the model that we published in 2007. Since then, we thought, well, now let's make an experiment. Now, experiment, I cannot have other modern humans emerging, clearly not, but if I say that a mental fact happens, I can study this mental fact in humans, and even I can study this mental fact in humans, which seems very easy because we are doing every day, and I can try to see with imaging what happens in the brain, and therefore check this hypothesis. So I said, wonderful, now we take a simple case, crosswords or whatever thing, we do it in a lab, or solving a puzzle, and then we put the same guy that does in the lab under a magnet, and we see what happens. Easy to say, very hard to do. A clear identification of strategy change without hints in laboratory did not exist. Because it's easy to say, but it's very hard to do it. It's very hard when you play chess, you change strategies, no doubt, but the way in which appears and when you change it is very hard to determine. Even in crosswords, it's hard to determine, very hard to determine. So much that, well, for every step I am telling to you, I had to read an enormous quantity of paper, because of course I am not an anthropologist, neither am a psychologist, nor am a neurologist. And by the way, I do not want to become any one of those. Let's make it clear. However, I must learn a bit what happens. And so, what experiments that I found? For instance, if the puzzle that you must solve is complex, you can stay days without solving, and at a certain moment appears the solution. How can you have an elaborate disappearance is very hard. The way in which it was done is that there are hints, so you have external influence, and then there is a way of trying to understand what the hints did, how much they helped. But this is not what we want. We want that. So we found zero example, and therefore, again, I'm a stubborn guy, we invented a test, a simple test. By the way, we inherited it from neuroeconomists, that is a test which called subtraction game. The subtraction game is a two-player's game in which there are n cases, and each player must move forward a pawn in turn. May turn in turn from one to k case for every move. And who gets at the end wins. Who gets to the end wins. This is the game. It's a very simple game, and we did the experiment with students of mine. Say the game is a triviality, and if both players play well, depending on what is G and K, the first player wins always, can win always if he plays well, for instance, let's stay in the NK case in which the first player plays well. We did that with a player and a computer, and we tested students and postdocs and PhD people in CISA, and we checked people. Being a linear move, being a linear strategy, you can get to these numbers in two ways, in one way or in another. Well, linear, you cannot cheat. Okay, so there is the forward method, which is exploration. You explore to get these correct moves, or there is what is called backward-induced. Backward-induced means in order to get there from where I must start. Now, the exploration is very simple mentally, but it's complex because you must play several times in order to get the number. While the backward-induced is more axiomatic, if you want, but it's very simple. If you get it, you solve immediately the problem. Now, everybody that have started and entered and got the correct numbers, started all of them from the first. from exploration. All started exploring. And 80%, for a game lasting, I don't know, 30 trials, 80% at a certain moment were fed up of this work and changed strategy. And we were able to determine in a precise way the moment of changing strategy. When I say a precise way, through behavioral attitude, time response, movement of eyes, movement of the mouth, and things like that. So we were able, we published the paper, it's funny how, yes, the paper, again, Charles here, said Alay is the student of mine. At CISA, the first paper was in cognition, this is thinking and reasoning, which is a psychological paper. So we succeeded in determining perfectly the moment of clearly recognizable strategy change. Then I said, wonderful, now that I have a clear recognition of strategy change in terms of behavioral data, I put the guy under a nuclear magnetic resonance and I find what happens in the brain. Easy to say, again, very difficult to do. Why? Because the brain makes many things. And I want to determine a change of strategy that you can do only once. Therefore, I must do a single trial. I have to do a single trial analysis. I cannot repeat, because once you know the strategy, the second strategy, you will apply always the second. And I cannot repeat with different subjects, because different subjects are completely different. Therefore, I said, no way. Neuroscientists only know to eliminate the noise. The brain is very noisy, not because it's only white noise, but the brain. You are breathing, thinking of your girlfriend, or what you have to do. A lot of things which are in phase, and it's very hard to eliminate the noise. It's very, very noisy. You see a picture of the brain, and you will see how noisy it is. So, we said, not possible to do. So, my neuroscientist friend said, forget about, let's change subject. Then we said, no, we must, there are some methods that are single trial cases, which are, I must go away from here. So, there are methods that may study single trial analysis, but then we said, let's do it first with a different test in which we can repeat, which is possible to repeat, then do first the average and then try, that has different phases. For instance, find the rule, find that there is a new rule, try to find it, get the rule and apply it, four different phases. Let's see if I make the average, what region of the brain contribute to these four different phases, and once I know, let's take again the same data and try to see if with this method of single trial we can succeed. Okay, we have done the work. Here is the group. The group improved because now there are more neuroscientists and there is also a machine person. This Jovicic is this was done in Trento where at that time we had the machine. And then finally we applied. We got the results. The result was published here. For instance, the dorsolateral is active in searching, frontopolar for finding and implementing, and so on. We got the result, and we published it. Then we said, wonderful, now let's take a single trial, and let's find out. We took a single trial with this multivariate method, and it failed totally. At this moment, my neuro colleague said, you see, we were right, impossible to do, bye-bye, and they all left me alone. I was totally wrong. However, a physicist will not give up so easily because, God, not to find a phase transition in a complex system cannot be. There are many complex systems in nature. There are many known phase transitions. So I started thinking about, I found at CISA a statistical mechanical physicist, which is a very bright guy, who was working with molecular dynamics, complex molecules that have different way to different possible ground states, and they can pass from one another. And he set up a method to find a phase transition in molecular dynamics. So I went to him and I said, how many data you put in your molecular dynamics? He said, 10,000. Well, a brain has 100,000, but one order of magnitude. Don't tell me that you cannot improve one order of magnitude with an intelligent way. So I seduced him, say, well, if you cannot apply this to understand what happens in the brain, you understand, well, what a molecule is a molecule, the brain is not peanuts. And so we started working on that, and 2 weeks ago, we got it finally, we succeeded, and we're writing the paper, and it is really incredible. It's a new technique. Now, this time, Elias is a friend of mine, but that is a student physicist from him, and my own is again a machine person. So, the voxels means the units of excitation are 100,000, as I told you, in the brain, and the important thing, and intensities for everyone are measured every 2 seconds for a total time of a few minutes. We put a very simple test, I will describe to you in a moment what is this simple test. The important thing is that what we want this time is to find a correlation. Therefore, we don't, the piece of the brain that interests us will be swamped by noise. However, the important thing is that we will have this piece of the brain that interests us will have the same time development. The question is to identify the same time development in a sea of different time developments. So, this is the way in which we have done it. I don't want to go into details because time is ending. For each voxel, we define first of all a distance. Two voxels have distance zero if they behave exactly the same in time. Therefore, small distance implies that over a window of time, the difference in time development is small. So we define a density then around each voxel. Density in this space, in the space of distance, not in distance in the brain, of distance in this excitation time development. Okay? I don't want to give you the smell of the method because it's a complex method. It took us 6 months to put in. Therefore, I don't want to put it into a pill. And then we grouped together all the voxels that have roughly the same small distance. It means the distance smaller than a certain distance, the cutoff. We put together with this, we define a dominant cluster, and then the secondary cluster, and so on. Okay. In a simple test, the simple test is the following. You get a guy, the instruction, press left button or right button, and then he presses. That's it. That's the test. With that test, we did an analysis, and I have here, this is the distance. Okay. That's the definition of distance. I forgot to put it in. Okay, is the time development within a certain window. Okay. The subject was scanned while moving the right or left hand. They saw walls move left, move right, and stop for in random fashion through the glasses. These are scans. Every scan lasts roughly two seconds, and therefore we did that on scans. And here I have, now, the next thing is a movie. But the movie must come here to do it. Let's see if I can do it here. I will show to you the movie of the leading cluster, This is the brain. Right is frontal, left is the backward cortex, visual, up and down, right and left, motor hand movement. Here it is. Look, it's very simple. You can see this. You see, there is no background. The brown is the leading. And you see that appears the visual part. Here it is. Then appears right and left, and the frontal part appears time to time, which is the frontal part that makes a decision. The blue one is the secondary one. He's the left movement, visual thing, and where is the frontal cortex? Up here. here it is, the frontal cortex was appearing. So we see in this film, by taking a small window, the leading part, which implies visual frontal to the side and then either right or left, exactly how it is the information, without any background. See, there is nothing else than the signal. Okay, now we are writing the paper, and here we are now. Once this thing will work, well, works for this simple test, we will go now back to this Brighton result that we had, and we will see if it works well in that more complex thing, and if it works, the data are already taken, therefore that would take a couple of months. And if it works well, we will make this game for finding latching, and we will apply it. Now, I have 5 minutes more. Okay, so I will tell you. So there we are. I am confident that in 1 or 2 years from now. I know that times there is always a relativistic time delay because it always appear new things in this game, but we will be able to put our finger on what is, for us, the essential new operation of that. Now, first of all, let me now discuss a couple of things which are of different kinds. The first one is the developmental aspect. If this fact is so late phylogenetically, that appears only now, it's also late ontogenetically, in the development of a person. So we had the idea, I again had to read papers on child development, which are even more than for neuroscience and anthropology put together. And we did an experiment with children. By the way, in reading this paper, I found out that children, for instance, speak very well, and they have language perfect at 8. However, there is a change at 8 or 10 years. The children don't use this infinite recursivity. They don't open a parenthesis within a sentence. They don't do it. And there are other things which are abstract that children don't do. And therefore I said, hi, there should appear my new thing. So we have checked with children of 8 to 10 years, and of course, not many, because, you see, to work with children is very complex. You must go to schools to have, say, committees for you cannot mistreat children. Therefore, it's a very complex thing. Therefore, we took only children of CISA. We made 8 children, and 8 over 8 didn't do any latching. Now, for me, 8 over 8 is a good statistics. 0 over 8 is a good statistic, I put it like that. So I said, good God, they don't do it at 8 or 10, they do it when they're adults. So I took adolescents, only 2 adolescents, but 2 over 2 did it. And therefore, for me, again, that's a good statistic. Of course, the paper could not be published because in order to publish for kids, you need to have at least 200, and with 200, you have ethical committees and things like that. Of course, I had propositions to handle it to psychologists, but to have psychologists working for me is a sin that I will not, taste. Okay. Anyhow, so it is late phylogenetically. Now, I even understood ontogenetically. I even understood why. Because, you see, as I told you, you change strategy when you are frustrated by the non-convenient strategy. And kids are never frustrated. They don't connect the feeling part of their brain with the logical part. They are nervous. They can go on playing the same game for 100 years. And the only frustration for them is that the game ended, because they would like to go ahead. So there was no frustration. Instead, for adolescents, immediately not to be able to find the correct way was a trauma, and they got it. Therefore, I even understood why, but. Okay, so there is this long-range correlation between the emotional part and the coherent. They are very emotional and very logical, but they don't want to work together. So, this is the first thing. And the second thing that I would like to, and with that I close, is anthropological aspects. How can happen that that this proposition of mine works. Because you see, what I'm saying is the following thing. Connectivity is, for us, the critical parameter. Now, connectivity gets a lot of information which is anatomic and genetically, but also external, if you want, epigenetical. Now, what happens? That at a certain moment, the cultural influences may have influenced connectivity, so to add to the evolutionary ones a bit, and with that overcome threshold. This smells Lamarckian, because smells that because this is universal, by the way, everybody does it, smells Lamarckian, but of course it's not Lamarckian. If there is a habit or a method that is convenient, everybody will adopt it. That's not Lamarck. So this could be the way. And then why the hell 40,000 or 70,000 years ago? What happened there? Now, there happened something important. First of all, the human population increased very much, and also the stability of the human population increased very much, and therefore their habits that became stable. For instance, family structure, the way of rearing kids, the parental-family relations, things like that, which are very universal, are the same for everybody, independent for every people in the world, by the way, which are, those are the convenient things that add to connectivity and help us to overcome the threshold, and there we are. Not only, but also there are some characteristics that come from that, which are taboos, for instance, in particular incest and anthropophagy, which are taboos, are forbidden somehow, and this is universal. Every human has, animals don't. Every human have, and by the way, have it even non-codified. Anthropophagy and incest are not among the 10 laws. They are not even punished by usual law. Indeed, there is incest, as you know well. If your daughter is above 18, you can go to bed with her, and you will not end into prison, even if it is not accepted. And therefore, it may well be that these social interventions, these structural, social structural interventions could have helped this increase in connectivity. Finally, there is also a possible common origin of human neural and psychological aspects. This is a paper I have just sent to neuropsychoanalysis. I feel a bit ashamed because of that. but this is impossible. You see, when I speak of incest and anthropophagy, ring bells that are of a different ballpark, and therefore this subjective side, very complex subjective side of human beings, which is the working of psychoanalysis in particular, appears to come up together with the cognitive one. Okay, there I am. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Daniel. It was great to come.
Matteo.
Comments, talk, questions?
So, if I understood correctly, you're saying that this long-range connection in the brain, or these long-range correlations in the activity in the brain, is something which is peculiar to humans? As not, because I know of, like, I've seen evidence of this in human, but has people done experiments in mammals?
Not for the time being. No. Of course, I pretend that sometimes they will do it. By the way, these are not the only. There are connections. There are coherent connections in brains, even in mammals. Clearly there are. However, first of all, if they involve if they involve, say, the the frontal part, which is very strongly developed in, and the I don't know. This I have not studied. Once I will see it in humans, I will see whether. But you see, it's very hard because even I cannot do a change of strategy without external inputs in animals. They don't do it. They don't do it. Really, this they don't do. Now I can study other things and to see how is organized the brain. But I leave that to animal people and not to me. The animal people are studying systematically the animal brain. They have never... Now, I'm looking into a small ballpark, which is the thing that is excited by this change of strategy, and this I cannot see in animals because they don't do it. Yes. However, I expect that they're also there. However, not necessarily this phase transition. They will have other things. I'm not saying that it's the only phase transition in the brain, by the way. So that...
More questions?
Your talk is very interesting, and it struck me that this idea of connectivity could perhaps be also in the modern times. There is a parallel with the rise of the internet and the collaboration between persons all over the world. And I think that this new connectivity might eventually produce some profound changes even in the human brain.
I cannot agree more. I absolutely agree. Indeed, I'm trying to think to investigate what I call. You see, here I say that the human, we are projectors. We have a project, and we work towards a project, and we find the correct strategy to work towards a project. This is the way in which we function. Yes. Now there is a new way of developing, which I call a Google mind, and say instead of developing a project, you put two or three keywords and you get somewhere. With two or three keywords, you get, then you have a connection from there and that you get somewhere else. And therefore, you can explore the possibilities of projects in a very different way, totally different way than the way in which you were done. And it is very possible that this can change many aspects of our functioning. Yes, I have not entered yet into that, but if I live enough, perhaps I will do it.
Well, it was a really excellent talk. I have many questions, but I'm going to ask one about this one. So, did you manage to identify the innate mental capacity, which is responsible for
the
this.
Innate,
which is responsible, because I would guess it is something like theory of mind, which you are referring to, because which led to eventually the social structure in the humans, and it came about 60,000.
Indeed, I believe that the innate is very limited. The connectivity very probably is very limited innately. And I am convinced that if you take innate connectivity, you take out a human at the moment of being born, and you have it reared by a Homo sapiens family of 100 years ago, say a Gedanken experiment, of course, you will get somebody that will not speak. But this is, for instance, I have one example that is very interesting, which indeed I told you, which are deaf people, there are two experiments which are extraordinarily good. One is in Negev, and the other one is Nicaragua. In Nicaragua, first of all, I'll tell you the Negev one. It was a close community of the order of 500 persons, which genetically had a lot of people which are deaf. The son of deaf people, if they remained in the family, they were never learning to language, real language. They were only having this home sign, which was possible to be used with the mother only, but never develop a language. At a certain moment, they grew, because they stabilized in Negev, they grew, and there were several kids together, and they started interacting together, and immediately born a new sign language, which is a real sign language, and not a proto-language, which is peculiar, which is not the Israeli sign language, neither the Arab sign language. It's a totally automatic sign language. Therefore, it is sufficient that it's exerted, the thing, through experimentation, that you develop the sufficient connectivity to have the language. So I believe that if there is no chance of developing these extrasomatic influences, very probably the connectivity will remain under threshold. This is my feeling. The Nicaragua one is still more interesting because it's a larger community, but
that language which you refer to contain recursive structure or not?
Yes, it's the same structure. The same structure, which is the same. It is the same structure, even if the rules are not the same as the sign language of both Israel and Arab, because this they developed by there. The other good example is Pilgrim English. You know, Pilgrim English also was developed by children, which were sons of slaves that were not speaking English at all. They were only speaking, indeed, with a few words. The kids got together and developed Pilgrim English, which is a total build-up language.
So, one more question. In the same language, how about the pragmatics part of the language? That means
how is
the pragmatics part. Language you define is you've got lexical structure, you have syntactical structure,
yes,
semantics.
Yes, yes. There's
all. There's pragmatics.
Yes.
So
the whole, Indeed, I have spoken with people of this Nicaragua business. They claim that the language has the exact correspondence with spoken language. Okay. And also there was done explicitly, not telling them, not teaching them any sign language. They were simply put together. And this developed alone.
So it is the next.
It's incredible, eh? Yes.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you for the very interesting presentation. Maybe if you can give a comment on the connection between the connectivity aspects which you discussed. When we talk about the phase transition or the appearance of the cognitive capacities in Homo sapiens, the connection to the number of people, so to the paleodemography aspects, because, you know, there are examples. For example, I know very well the situation of the human evolution in Australia, where you had a small number of Homo sapiens left, and when Cook went there in 1788, they were still in the Stone Age, they didn't need to develop the wheel or
Absolutely.
The writing and so on, yet they had, you know, they were the same Homo sapiens that already in Africa had developed.
Yes.
So if you can comment on the demography aspect.
For me it's very hard, because you are totally right. I believe that this influence and connectivity, very probably is not given by the number, but is given by some habits. Now, the habits are related to the number, because, for instance, the family structure, the fact that the rearing of human beings is changed completely when the number of people overcome a certain quantity. The rearing, the fact of the familiar, not anymore the clan rearing, but the family rearing. And therefore, I believe that there are social problems which are related to the number that at a certain moment enter into the game, and that is the moment in which these things appear. By the way, you see, I believe that in many, for instance, I have followed with this universality that happens also with the isolated population. At a certain moment, they also make the transition. And they can make the transition because sometimes it's sufficient to know that certain ways of reading or certain ways of parentophilia relations are convenient to get some capacities, and therefore they can be inherited even if there is not the number pressure. You see, sometimes it could be the examples of somebody else. Therefore, all that must enter together. I cannot quantitatively answer your question, but I believe that this is an important fact. Yes, not the only one, but it's important.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to see this kind of multidisciplinary approach. I have one question. What about the fossil record, the evidence of the fossil record?
Okay.
Fossil record.
Fossil record, yes.
For instance, you speak about modern humans, but we know that Neanderthals, for example, had developed almost all the capacities.
No. Yes. No, well, there were schools in which the Neanderthals were put very nearby, because, by the way, we lived together for quite some time. Therefore, it's true that we lived together to eliminate them more than to mate them. But, for instance, people now believe that Neanderthals were not speaking. I don't know. I can only advise you to see what these people say. For people that have lived very nearby us, as Neanderthals, can be even a copying. By the way, for instance, Neanderthals seem that they can mate with humans, and therefore can be also. However, they have. Obviously not very well, because there are not mixed populations. They have been simply eliminated.
I do not agree, because a lot of evidence suggests that they have developed the language and also the culture, because we have found evidence of paintings, cultures, and maybe music also. And also the brain morphology, even if different, they have quite a huge irrigation blood system.
Yes.
So it seems that they already had a similar.
It seems not. Well, I cannot enter into a domain which is not mine. I only can tell you that I studied a lot paleo data. And I have seen a lot of, in general, I got from them that it is obvious that you can have the fan of Neanderthals as you have the fan of chimpanzees. There is, for instance, a woman that believes a chimpanzee can do exactly the same thing that we do. I have even heard her, and it's something rather painful, because it's obvious you can never break down a good example. This is not the opinion that they had. Neanderthals were very similar to us. By the way, their brain was larger than ours. Perhaps not so well organized. I don't know. This is something that gets out of my
thank you.
Ballpark.
More questions? So can we say that this 40 to 70,000 years is based, is not before or not after, not before, because it was social aspects that made that
humans get together? Anatomically and genetically, humans were the same. They have not changed. Homo sapiens, of course, Neanderthals are a different thing. Mm-hmm. But Homo sapiens did not change, were the same. Nevertheless, before a certain period, they were not capable as we are.
Mm-hmm. It's close to the period that agriculture started.
Agriculture started afterwards. So, people got together in the units of life even before developing agriculture. Agriculture mm-hmm. is a more sophisticated thing. It needs irrigation, needs a separation of tasks and things of that kind that appear afterwards.
Yeah, but it's a few thousand, it's like 20,000 years later or something.
Yes. So and writing appears even later.
Right. So you think agriculture would be an effect of this instead of a consequence of the...
No, what I would say is that, human cognitive capacity are not sufficient to do everything, of course. There are technological developments that keeps changing, and very quickly. Very quickly. I always say I am 80 years old, and I am convinced that from 70,000 up to now, I have assisted roughly about 20% of the change. Therefore, we keep changing, and more quickly. It's exponential. And you see, the exponential is that for every period, you double in the same way. And therefore, I'm convinced that that this is the ingoing of projectuality. However, in between projectuality and successful projects, you have to master nature. For instance, agriculture implies mastering water, and these are technical things that develop much later. As the writing, for instance, writing is much, much more. Okay. So that's only the before 50,000, 70,000, we were not humans. We were humans anatomic. We were not able to understand the world and to change. We were just living in, and that's it. Much the same as Homo erectus did, or everybody else. At a certain moment, we start changing slowly, and then accelerating, and in between yesterday and today, we change quite a bit.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Daniel.
Thank you.